good morning. I also want to thank Barbara and Jan for inviting me to present this talk. So they ask me, I will not talk about great earthquake, but about great fault and the link between this great fault that generates such great earthquake in Asia and the possible continental plate tectonic associated with continental subduction. So the deformation of the continent have sometimes been presented as distributed due to the homogeneous distribution, of the seismicity, as you can see on this map, with each earthquake of magnitude superior to 5 with the same size. But if you plot the size of the earthquake according to the energy release, you see only on this map the great earthquake that releases about 80% of the seismic energy. The rupture long segment of fault, as you can see here in red along the Kunlun fault, and cut ASEAN in block limited by this great fault. Some of the segments associated with continental subduction, like here along the Himalaya or here in Pamir. Therefore, could we talk about continental plate tectonics, as in the model of Taponnier and collaborator, where you can see here on this figure the block geometry deduced from the fault geometry. In this model, only the upper crust thickens, here in pink on this chematic fault section, while the lithospheric mantle in green subducts. In another unmember model, the soft Tibet model of Royden and collaborator, they focus on the rheology of the lower crust that is supposed mostly ductile, and they infer a wide Indian slab below the soft and buoyant Tibetan crust. So one of the most striking differences between these two models is the lithospheric structure beneath Tibet, and we will try to constrain these roots. So in the first part of the talk, I will talk about the upper crust deformation and use fault rate and offset to do 2D tectonic reconstruction. Then I will use global tomography to try to better constrain the slab geometry beneath Tibet. And at the end, I will present some results about the dynamic of the processes by doing numerical and analog modeling. So quickly, the deformation of the upper crust, I will present two results, an old one upon the Red River Fault and a very new one on the Chanchuire Fault. On this spot images of the Red River Fault, you can see very clearly about 60 kilometers of the fault traits, very, very linear, offsetting systematically all the river here by a dextral offset. But each individual offset of the river has a different value, except if you apply a 25 kilometer total offset, you can reconstruct the entire drainage network, as for example, these three rivers here. By dating the tectonic inversion at the southeast extremity of the fault in the Tonkin Gulf using a seismic line at about 5 million years, I deduce a mean Pliocene rate of about 5 millimeters per year. Then I will present some recent results about the Chanchuire fault system here. Several segments have been mapped along this fault, here in red, orange, and yellow. And on this kind of 3D map, you can see very different regions, like this surface here in brown, that are very flat and have been using thermochronology, we can show that there is not much exhumation since the Cretaceous that you can see here in front of this picture. And it's located very close to the Chanchuire fault, showing that the deformation here is very localized along the fault. But there is also other region with very active exhumation, like this very high massif of the Gongashan here with very high peak, far above the mean altitude of the plateau. We did We collect sample here along this profile here and make thermochronologic dating. So I will not explain you in detail the method here. But we did use from our result elevation age profile, rapid exhumation started at 9 million years at about 2 kilometers per million years. So it's a paper that we really recently published, so it's much more complex that I make it short here. So if you want to discuss more about that, we can do that later. By using the total offset that has been documented for the fault between the thrust of the Longmanshan to the north of the fault and to the thrust here to the south of the fault, about 60 kilometers, we can deduce an average slip rate for the Shanshuire fault system at about 7 millimeters per year since about 9 million years. Then I did tectonic reconstruction to constrain the rigid motion of blood that are delimited by the Great Fault of Asia, constrained by such fault rate and offset. As for example, for this first time step, the motion between Indochina and China is about 25 kilometers, the total offset that are determined for the Red River Fault. Then I restore the block continuity and change the fault network accordingly to continue the rest the reconstruction backward in time. This tectonic reconstruction is a very useful view of the upper crust evolution using the great displacement documented along the Great Fault of Asia. As for example, the motion of the Indochina block here in green, sliding for more than 700 kilometer along the High Laotian shear zone here, and that even offset the eastern coast of Asia. It's also very, very useful to see the position of India during the collision and the relating position of the suture within Asia. But how to accommodate this great displacement at the lithospheric scale? So now I will show you the slab geometry using global tomography. The goal is to better understand the coupling between the tectonic of Asia and the formation of the Tibetan plateau, like you can see here in red on this topographic global map, and the regional geodynamic, in particular the northward motion of India and its collision with Asia since about 50 million years. So I will first focus on the Pamir in the western part of the collision. In this region, you have the deepest intracontinental seismicity in the world, showing two ongoing continental subduction with opposite versions. First here to the south beneath the Hindu Kush, ongoing subduction with a vertical slab reaching about 600 kilometer depth that you can see along this section, along this line here, using P-wave global tomography, where the slab appears as blue, positive blue anomaly. It has been interpreted as the Indian slab dipping northward. And if we look along this section here, the slab is less steep and reaches only 400 kilometer depth, and has been interpreted as an Asian slab dipping southward. So on this enlarged tomographic section here, across the Hindu Kush, the shallow slab represented here in orange on this schematic cross-section is located far north of this deep anomaly here in the lower mantle, represented in green here, that has been interpreted as the slab of the Tethys Ocean, detached from the Indian continent at the beginning of the collision and sinking in the mantle since then. More to the east here, along this line, the geometry of the slab is very different, in particular with this prominent anomaly here that have been interpreted as a portion of the Indian continent detach from the shallow continent and sinking in the mantle. To really interpret this anomaly, you have to analyze both the vertical section and the horizontal section and compare them with the tectonic reconstruction. For example, here on this section at 1,200 kilometer depth, you can see the geometry of the deep anomaly here, interpreted as the Tethys slab, here in green on this schematic cross section, and that match the ASEAN margin deduced from the tectonic reconstruction. Shallower anomaly represent younger subduction event. First, here the break-off of the oceanic slab at the boundary, the ocean continent boundary, represented here in 3D. Then after the north of the locus of the oceanic subduction, the Indian plate subduct, leading to this anomaly here, represented here on this sketch, which also detached from the continent. And at more recently, you have the subduction of a very narrow slab beneath that we have seen beneath the Hindu Kush. Also here, this anomaly here that is located parallel to the oceanic slab, but north of it and even north of the Indian slab, could be the, slab, ASEAN slab that could have subducted beneath either the Jinsha or the Bangong suture. So by doing this couple analysis between 2D tectonic reconstruction and global tomography, it is possible to make a 3D lithospheric reconstruction that you can see here schematically, with to the west the vertical subduction of the Indian plate beneath the Hindu Kush, facing the ASEAN subduction beneath the Pamir. We have a lot of lateral variability, and in central Tibet, you have a subduction beneath the Kunlun suture not associated with deep seismicity, the underplating of the Indian plate, and in the lower mantle, a slab, a previous Indian and ASEAN slab may be related to a previous subduction event. The analysis of the global tomography seems that it's not compatible with the prediction of the soft Tibet model. We don't see such a very thick lithospheric slab. It's probably more valid for the continental plate tectonic, but it's probably not so simple that it has been inferred in the theoretical case. So now I will use this result to show you the dynamic of processes as continental subduction and slab break-off. First, I did, in collaboration with Fabio Capitano, numerical model of the upper plate deformation that you can see here in blue on this 3D diagram of the model, showing no density contrast with the mantle, due to the subduction of the continental plate here in green, showing a small density contrast, attached to an oceanic plate here in red with a strong density contrast. The free plate has a viscoplastic rheology and evolve upon the conservation of mass and momentum equation. So we impose a break-off at the ocean continent boundary by reducing locally the plastic limit, either a partial break-off here or a complete break-off here along the entire continent boundary. We show with this experiment that after the break-off of the oceanic root slab here, the continent in green resumes subducting. In fact, the complete break-off preserves the poloidal mantle flow in the center of the slab that you can see here with the flow line here in black, which is dragging the continental plate in the mantle, represented by this black arrow here, showing a vertical component of motion in the middle of the plate, while on the edge of the plate, this white arrow here show a mostly horizontal component of motion, and here indentation of the upper plate occur. So this stress coupling gradient at the trench generates the stress in the upper plate that you can see here on the top view of the experiment, which localizes along a stress belt here at an angle with the trench of about 45 degrees, both with the partial or the complete break-off. And in the case of no break-off, you have only shearing at the margin and no deformation of the upper plate. But we made a second series of models to see if this stress coupling gradient at the trench could induce a spontaneous slab break-off. We add a wide oceanic plate here in red to the side of the continental plate in blue. We add also far field forces that are superior in magnitude to the ridge push. And in that case, what we have, first, the subduction of the oceanic plate. Then, when the continent arrived at the trench, we have a spontaneous break-off here that you can see in transparency, where the strongest stress occur at the ocean continent boundary, which generates the deformation of the plate, upper plate, while the continent here advance, and if you add sufficient far field force here, you have not so much retreat of the oceanic plate. So again, the top view of the stress during the oceanic subduction, we have no stress in the upper plate. The stress is only at the trench. When the continent arrived at the trench, the break-off occur and the indentation began, and with the indentation, the stress in the upper plate appear. When the indentation is strong, we have also a strong deformation of the upper plate with lateral motion between the continent moving north and the oceanic plate here retreating. We can compare with the tectonic reconstruction here, with this limit between the high stress and the no stress in the upper plate geometry could be compared to the Eylau-Shan shear zone geometry, bonding the Indochina block here that is also moving to the east. We have only this deformation of the upper plate if we add some far field force here that push the plate superior to the ridge push. But in this kind of model, we have no rupture in the upper plate and no Asian continental subduction. So to try to model the subduction of the Asian continental lithosphere, we did analog modeling. So I did that in the Roma Free University in collaboration with Francesca Funicello, who will present something this afternoon, and Claudio Facena. We use silicon putty, a viscoelastic material quasi-Newtonian at experimental strain rate as analog of lithosphere, and glucose syrup as a Newtonian fluid as analog of the mantle. The experimental setup is very similar to the one we use in the numerical model that I presented before, with a continental plate here lighter than the mantle, pushed also by a piston that is the analog of the far field forces, attached to a dense oceanic plate, but in front of this indenter, the upper plate is cut in two. In orange here, the, what we call the upper plate, and another plate, the back wall plate, attached to the back wall of the box. We scale the experiment for length, time, and velocity. And in the following of the talk, you will see only the top view of the experiment or the side view. So we published this result last year. So during the experiment, first we have the subduction of the oceanic plate that you can see here in black that subducts under its own weight. Then when the indenter arrives to the margin pushed by the piston, there is a vertical component of motion. The continent is pulled in the mantle by the dense oceanic slab. But after a while, there is no more vertical component and only horizontal component of the indenter, which at the end reach about two-thirds of the box, and you see it deforms a lot and overturns. During the entire experiment, the back wall plate subduct, not attached to any dense slab. At the end, the slab is steep, but not vertical, and reach about one-third of the box. So you are here, you can see here in green the evolution of the back wall slab during the experiment, and here in pink the evolution of the indenter slab. We estimate the absorption of the convergence during the experiment by subduction, about 40%, about 25% for the indenter and 15% for the back wall slab, and also 60% by the thickening of the plate that you can see here on the top view of the experiment. So recently, we have done some new experiments that are not published yet to try to understand the mental kinematics and dynamics of this counterintuitive subduction of the back wall plate, not driven by positive slab pull, because this slab is lighter than the mantle, and not attached to any dense slab, like it is the case for the indenter. So for this experiment, we have put some small air bubble in the mantle, and we have light the experiment from below, and we can follow the trajectory of the micro air bubble. This is this black vector here, showing the velocity field. On this picture, we draw the flow line also to better see the convective cell. So first, with the subduction, the oceanic subduction, we have two big pair of convective cells on both sides of the slab, with mostly the vertical component of velocity that dominate the mantle flux. When the oceanic slab touches the bottom of the box and the indenter is just entering the trench here, we have two convective cells here, one associated with the upper plate that began to thicken, and another one with the back wall plate. This is a very short transient convective cell, and after, almost the entire experiment is dominated by the advance of the indenter, the advance of the indenter slab here, and a very wide horizontal cell with mostly horizontal component of motion here, which seem to passively advecting the back wall slate. The Here it is the velocity magnitude that are represented in color. So you see very strong vertical motion associated with the oceanic subduction. The convective cell associated with the upper plate and back wall plate are very low in magnitude and very short in time, but they might favor the initiation of the back wall plate subduction here at this moment. And after, we can see that the indenter is transmitting the push of the piston, and we call that the tectonic horizontal forces, which induce a strong horizontal component of motions of both at the surface, at the lithospheric scale here, but also in the mantle, and this yellow velocity here, that push the back wall slab in the mantle, and even here, with a difference of velocity magnitude on both sides of the slab, that suggests that the mantle is also pushing the back wall slab in the mantle. So to conclude, we have the rigid continental lithosphere that subduct, but in a collision context, which is here forced by the push of the piston. The slab pull is not the driving force of this subduction here, of this slab here, but this subduction is driven by the tectonic forces, mostly horizontal, so generated here artificially by the motion of the piston. And in that case, maybe the term subduction is not describing adequately this process, and we had talk about collisional subduction. We could also talk about forced subduction in that case. So the conclusion is that by coupling the 2D tectonic reconstruction and using fault rate and offset and the position of the slab in a global tomography, it is possible to make 3D lithospheric reconstruction that shows the importance of continental subduction of both the Indian and the Asian plate lithosphere during the collision. So we have done some numerical and analog modeling to try to better understand the mantle kinematics and dynamics associated with such counterintuitive subduction, not driven by positive slab pull. And we show the importance of the tectonic horizontal forces and show that the continental plate tectonics is dynamically sustainable. All the model that I show you, we have not been able to model the entire complexity of this process. We have on the numerical experiment, we have more the slab break-off and that show that we can have the subduction of the Indian plate even after a slab break-off. And with the analog experiment, it's not possible to make the slab break-off, but we have focus on the analog of the ASEAN slab collision. Okay, I stop here if you have some questions.